Undeniable, Part 9. We have been studying the book Undeniable by Douglas Axe, subtitled How Biology Confirms Our Intuition That Life is Designed, published by HarperCollins in this year. Today we're going to finish the book. There's a cover. To summarize a summary of the book that was on the cover, Douglas Axe argues that the key to understanding our origin is the design intuition, the innate belief held by all humans that tasks we would need knowledge to accomplish can only be accomplished by someone who has that knowledge. For the ingenious task of inventing life, this knower can only be God. There is science that proves our design intuition is valid. Everyday experience can empower ordinary people to defend their design intuition. Living creatures are brilliantly conceived, utterly beyond the reach of accident. In chapter 1, a question was raised called the big question: what is the source from which everything else came? Or to bring it closer to home, to what or to whom do we owe our existence? Chapter 1 then is summarized what the rest of the book was going to be about. And chapters 13 and 14 are the end. And so he says, finally, chapters 13 and 14 complete our journey. There we examine the nature of life and humanity more deeply, leading to a clear picture of what the answer to the big question is, after which I offer a glimpse of what I hope biology will look like in the not too distant future, after a great many people join us on this journey. Chapter 13, First World. I haven't shied away from naming God as the knower who made us. I see no other way to make sense of everything we've encountered on our journey. By recognizing that life can't be an accident, we're affirming that life was intended, and considering the stunning genius with which this intent was carried out, I'm compelled to see God as the genius behind it. Still, thinking in particular of Thomas Nagel, I want to put my finger on what it is that makes the alternative hypothesis of a purposeful but impersonal natural order untenable to me. As we approach the end of our journey, the time has come to address this. Nagel is drawn to the subject of mind, and so am I. Perhaps the most awe-inspiring aspect of the outside world is that we each view it from our own inside world. Not only that, but we are active participants in the outside world. Like operators of diesel-powered earth movers, we each have a seat on the inside from which we can see the world outside while also acting to change it. How is this possible? Clearly it is, or we wouldn't be here to talk about it. Still, once we get past its familiarity, this marvelous truth ought to stir wonder and amazement in us. The children whose simple view of life has proved superior to the view endorsed by the Royal Society and the National Academy also have a simple view of consciousness. Their view begins to take shape in infancy with games like peekaboo, where small hands over small eyes form a screen that momentarily isolates the inside world from the outside world. With the screen in place, the view from inside is one of darkness and mounting anticipation. Then the hands are flung from the eyes and the anticipation is rewarded, always with shrieks of approval. Through countless learning moments like this, children build a connection between their inside world and the outside world, a connection far more profound than anything technology has given us. Further exploration deepens the connection. The child begins to recognize that certain special participants in the outside world, mommy, daddy, sister, brother, are also viewing it from an inside world, their own inside world. This understanding is imperfect at first. The child initially thinks that by covering his eyes, he closes off the outside world for everyone. Later, he learns that mommy's eyes are the window to her inside world, just as his eyes are to the window of his. And so the child's internal model of reality is refined. With increasing internal understanding comes increasing external expectations, along with consequences for successes and failures in meeting these expectations. Learning from both, the child eventually attains full self-awareness, making decisions with the understanding that they have an effect on the outside world, and those effects will be observed by other people, and that the observers may respond with decisions of their own. Of course, in coming to this view of reality, no one feels as though they're doing science or philosophy. Indeed, this common sense view seems so natural that few of us give it a second thought. Thinkers, thoughts, and things. When we ponder this view for a moment, it seems to place the components of reality into three categories. I'll call them thinkers, thoughts, and things. The outside world consists entirely of things, galaxies, atoms, trees, computers, etc., where each inside world consists of the mental space in which one thinker has thoughts. I refer to this personal space as a workshop at the close of chapter 10 because each person works upon his or her own thought projects within it. This view stirs controversy when we take it back to the question that started our journey. What is the source from which everything else came? Immediately, another interesting question arises. If reality presently consists of thinkers, thoughts, and things, which of these three should we see as being primary in the sense of having been the source of the other two? As I mentioned at the outset, materialists hold things to be primary, whereas theists hold thinkers to be primary. Most notably, the divine thinker we call God. Hence the tension. The struggle for materialists has always been to explain how things could really be primary. For things even to be the source of all things seems impossible. The spider's spinning apparatus is certainly a thing, but because it's one of those special things we call inventions, we've concluded that it can't have originated by accident. Only a thinker could have brought spinnerets into existence, and a highly clever thinker at that. Up to this point, our discussion has focused almost entirely on that one key failure of materialism, its inability to explain inventions. Nagel and a good many others have pointed out another failure, which happens to be one of my own reflections first turned to during my undergraduate days. More profound than the failure to explain invention, this other failure is that materialism is categorically incapable of explaining either thinkers or their thoughts. As Doug Axe put it earlier, physical systems are governed by physical laws. With our minds, we are able to control our physical bodies. Our minds can take precedence over physical laws and are therefore non-physical. That which is constrained by physical laws cannot give rise to something that takes precedence over those laws. Therefore, man did not evolve from the physical. We are not mere things. Within the limits of our capabilities, we do whatever we want to do without answering to any equation. But while we are masters over the physical in that sense, we are slaves in another. Our bodies are physical things, subject to physical needs and vulnerable to physical conditions. Without food, water, and rest, they cease functioning properly, and our minds are quick to follow. In fact, our minds are particularly sensitive to certain material influences. The most active thinker among us can't stand up to a dose of propofol, a common drug for inducing general anesthesia. So the same minds that spend their waking hours manipulating matter are rendered completely inactive by a small amount of matter of a certain kind. The point is not that we stand wholly above the material world, as God is said to, but rather that we occupy a position that so categorically defies material explanation as to refute the materialist position over and above the refutation that most of this book was devoted to. A simple thought experiment should convince everyone of this. Imagine yourself seated inside a brain imaging laboratory surrounded by complicated equipment, some of which is connected to you by means of wired probes stuck into your scalp and forehead. You are fully conscious, not alarmed in the least by your surroundings, in no need of sedation. We can do this in a thought experiment. And in fact, you are calmly conversing with the brain scientist standing before you in his white lab coat. You were thoroughly intimidated by him when you were escorted into the lab, but the conversation soon took such an amusing turn that all that intimidation vanished. I'm still trying to pinpoint exactly what you mean when you say two, he says with more than a hint of frustration. I keep telling you what I mean. Two is the next whole number after one. One more than one. Which is one more than none. Exactly. Yes, well, that all sounds very nice, but I can assure you that every one of your thoughts is nothing but a physical manifestation of this mass of neurons that are sits inside your skull. And I can likewise assure you that I am recording and imaging absolutely everything going on in there. Very expensive equipment this is, the very latest. And yet, whenever I show you something on this display that looks very promising to me, you keep insisting it is not at all what you mean by two. I might have overlooked this if we had fared any better with any of the other words we tried. Circle, triangle, line, around, between, love, hate, true, false, one, and none. But as things stand, I'm beginning to think this whole exercise has been a colossal waste of time. My time, that is. And no, I most certainly do not want to know what you mean by time. Do you see the problem? The meaning we attach to these words is nowhere to be found in a person's brain or in any other physical location for that matter. Of course, some of these words may describe various aspects of the brain, but to describe a thing is not at all the same as to be indistinguishable from it, identical to it. Yes, two happens to be the number of cerebral hemispheres. But it is also the number of Martian moons, the number of sides of a coin, the number of Nobel Prizes awarded to Fred Sanger, and the number of sequels to A Fistful of Dollars. In the larger scheme, all these are small contingent realities, whereas two itself towers above them as a permanent, universal, necessary reality. Or at least I can make no sense of anything apart from this review. To say that a statement is true is to say something significant precisely because true is another of those necessary realities. If true were anything less, a physical process in a brain lobe, or a substance that could be packed into 50 milligram tablets, or an object that could be photographed, then the lofty meaning we attach to true would be a mirage, and this activity we're doing right now, called reasoning, would instantly collapse into a heap of pretentious nonsense. Indeed, our very sanity is at stake here. If the meanings we ascribe to nearly every word we use are as completely mistaken as the scientists in our thought experiment suggested, then every sentence uttered or written throughout history of human thought has been fundamentally confused. And in thinking otherwise, we show our thoughts to be every bit as confused as our words. In fact, we couldn't even have thoughts. But once we reject the materialistic premise, we see irony instead of insanity. The reality of truth makes reason possible, which in combination with physical observation makes science possible. No one should deny the importance of science, but neither should anyone deny the importance of the more fundamental realities that lend meaning to science. By doing just that, materialism and scientism invalidate the very discipline they seek to elevate. In the end, it seems the children are right again. The inside world is every bit as real as the outside one. Consciousness and free will are not illusions, but foundational aspects of reality, categorically distinct from the stuff of the outside world. Following the children, if we allow ourselves to see the outside world as an expression of God's creative thought, everything begins to make sense. Far from peculiarities to be explained away, consciousness and free will are at the very center of all reality, just as they are at the center of us. We love to think and create and express ourselves because we are created to do so by a God who has surrounded us with exquisite proof that he loves these same activities. The primacy of personhood. Can there be any other coherent view of reality then? On this point, I find Thomas Nagel's transparency extremely refreshing. As I mentioned in Chapter 1, he wants there to be an alternative, a fully coherent view of reality where God is absent. I've never felt that desire, but I can relate to the underlying cosmic authority problem Nagel describes, at least to a degree. Hasn't each of us wanted to be his or own authority, accountable to no one but ourselves? I've never wished God out of the existence during those moments, but I certainly have felt his presence to be something of inconvenience, to put it mildly. All of this I regard as part of the human condition, and being human, I'm wholly sympathetic. Nevertheless, while I admire the way Nagel thinks and agree with much of his reasoning, I find his atheistic position fundamentally untenable. Nagel affirms that our clearest moral and logical reasonings are objectively valid, and he rejects the materialist view on the grounds that it lacks even the categories for treating these reasonings as real. Having dispensed with the dominant academic view in that way, he seeks alternatives that make mind, meaning, and value as fundamental as matter and space-time in an account of what there is. I would say even more fundamental, but I would otherwise agree with all this, as with Nagel's more complete description of what we should be looking for. The hope is not to discover a foundation that makes our knowledge unassailably secure, but to find a way of understanding ourselves that is not radically self-undermining and that does not require us to deny the obvious. The aim would be to offer a plausible picture of how we fit into the world. Well put. And yet it seems to me that Nagel's careful probing of the deficiencies of materialism shows the missing category to be not just moral or logical reasoning, but something considerably bigger. As I mentioned at the start of chapter 10, Nagel is seeking a version of the natural world that produces the things of personhood, consciousness, reason, and moral sense as part of the expected course of events. In other words, he wants a version of nature that, once accepted, demystifies the appearance of all these remarkable inventions we've been considering along our journey, including the higher faculties of humans. Everyone sees the difficulty of constructing what Nagel is calling for, including Nagel himself. But we don't want to dismiss the project just because it looks hard. I find myself having to reject it for two other reasons. Notice he's not saying it looks hard, therefore it probably can't be done. He says, first, when I try to imagine a way of understanding the world that meets Nagel conditions, I'm left to think that the mystery he wants to eliminate can only be displaced. Humans might be the expected outcome if this hypothesized picture of nature were correct, but that only makes the picture itself mysterious. Of all the attributes this impersonal thing we're calling nature might have had, why would it have had the astonishing attributes needed to produce such astonishing things? My second reason is that I honestly think Nagel is rejecting the obvious. What is conspicuously neglected in materialism and in Nagel's hope for alternative to materialism is personhood, not as something derived but as something fundamental. Indeed, if the aim is to understand how we fit into the world, then the subject of we deserves as much attention as the subject of world. Materialism has committed the glaring error of adding we only in at the very end as an afterthought, and Nagel should be thanked for pointing this out with admirable clarity, but even he entertains a rather truncated and fragmented notion of we, I think. We know from what we've discussed that the cause we owe our existence to cannot be accidental. Nagel agrees. But to avoid a personal understanding of purpose, he seeks a natural one instead, where things happen because they're on a path that leads toward certain outcomes, notably the existence of living and ultimately conscious organisms. So this cause brought us into existence as if we were intended. And to do so, this cause must have been in possession of what amounts to astonishing insight. All this is clear. Add to it the fact that this cause must have encompassed the very categories that Nagel addresses, conscious mind and rational faculties and moral sense, and if I were in Nagel's shoes, I would find the resulting profile to be unnervingly personal. If the obvious solution to all this is to acknowledge the reality of a personal God, why go to such strained lengths to withhold this acknowledgement? Having now dipped our toes in these intriguing waters of reconciling our inner and outer worlds, why not just dive in? In 128 pages, Nagel unraveled 150 years of Western thought by taking seriously a few obvious aspects of humanity. Why not go further? Yes, we are conscious thinkers with a moral sense, but that's hardly an adequate description. We are also friends and lovers, and then he goes on to list a whole bunch of other things that we are. Diving in. Let's take a moment to wade into the shallow end before we dive into the deep end. Have a look at figure 13.1, where you'll see things that are instantly recognized as manufactured objects, even if we have no idea what they are. They are indeed manufactured out of a hard, silica-based material similar to opal. I'll also tell you that each of them is tiny enough to fit on the end of a strand of human hair. They kind of look manufactured, don't they? With that, I think you'll agree that they are remarkable manufactured objects exhibiting both technological sophistication and elegance of form. Figure 13.2, which we'll see in a little bit, shows some close-up details. Where did these remarkable manufactured things come from? Are you perhaps picturing a giant nanofabrication facility in Silicon Valley? If so, you would be blown away to hear that these are actually outer casings from single-celled algae called diatoms. It's true. The factories that produce these exquisite pieces of tech art were the individual algal cells that lived within them. Sarah Spaulding, an ecologist with the U.S. Geological Survey, who has identified dozens of diatom species, says, "I think that if only other people could see diatoms, they would be just as obsessed as me. I know the feeling. Just viewing pictures like these triggered a similar passion in me, almost as though I'm seeing things from another world, the exquisite craftsmanship of an alien superintelligence." Here's a close-up. And for those of you who are wondering, at this scale, a pixel of an iPhone 6 Retina display would be twice the width that you see here. Here's an interesting thought then. What if we were meant to be exhilarated by experiences of this kind? And furthermore, what if we were meant to know this? What if this thrill, our inner world becoming ecstatic about our outer world, was meant to be something even deeper and more personal than mere discovery? I'm skipping over a bit more. By the way, I'm trying to summarize and get to the core of what he has to say. I certainly am not taking the place of the book, and I recommend that those of you who are interested further read the book. Closure. The first world then seems to be not the world of mere thinkers, but the world of persons, complete with personhood and personalities. Certainly this is the richest world, not just comparatively, but categorically, which makes nonsense of any thought that a lesser one brought this greater one into being. We have our answer then, and we can thank the children for declaring it. The source from which everything else came is not a what, but a who. Of the millions of species participating in this remarkable adventure called life, only ours has been given the ability to grasp this most crucial truth. We can, and we do from an early age. Perhaps we also should grasp it, and having grasped it, perhaps we should hold on to it. Maybe we should pay less heed to the internal tensions that would pry this truth from us and more to the truth itself. This truth does, after all, have every appearance of being good, so maybe we resist it for no good reason. If personhood is at the very center of reality, and if the resonance between us and our Creator is as deep as we have seen, then friendship with Him can't be far off. Who knows? He might even understand our cosmic authority problem. Chapter 14, The New School. Reflection is valuable near the end of a successful journey. Thinking back, we started with what seemed like very little. We had nothing but the unresolved question of where we came from and the determination to follow the truth to the answer. The problem wasn't that we had no answer, but rather that we had two answers that contradicted each other. In our childhood, if not since, our design intuition assured us that life could only be the handiwork of God or someone like Him. As universal as this intuition is, though, It is almost universally opposed by the technical experts on life. None of us have been able to erase the intuition, but many of us have struggled to defend it against this professional opposition, or even to know whether it ought to be defended. And I guess I would say that some of us have struggled to defend the professional opinion against the early intuition. Summoning our courage, we set out to see whether there might be more to this humble intuition than meets the eye. Everything in our experience told us this had to be so. Some things really are too good to happen by accident. And if experience affirms this principle even for mundane things like bricks and shoes, how can exquisite things like spiders and orcas and diatoms be exceptions? Having now added to our experience this journey we've nearly completed, we see that, far from being exceptions, living things are the most striking examples of this principle. No high-level function is ever accomplished without someone thinking up a special arrangement of things and circumstances for that very purpose, and then putting these thoughts into action. The hallmark of all these special arrangements is high-level functional coherence, which by now we know comes only by insight, never by coincidence. This vindication of our design intuition has been one of the major accomplishments along our journey, but there have been others. Having been reminded of how human scientists are, we've learned to let go of the utopian version of science, which never resembled real science anyway. Likewise, with the affirmation of our design intuition came the realization that scientific thinking is part of what we all naturally do. The community of professional scientists gets some things right and some things wrong, just as every other community does. All humans are scientists, and all scientists are humans. Topping off these accomplishments is the weighty realization that the great cause of everything clearly reveals himself not as an impersonal force, but as a very personal God. Even this fits with the universal and design intuition. Creation is only ever accomplished by drawing upon what exists, and personhood, so fundamental to our existence, must therefore have come from someone in whom it already existed. Persons can also only come from a personal God. We had the right answer to our big question back in our childhood, though for many of us it was misplaced somewhere between then and now. Thankfully, what was lost has now been found. We owe our existence to the personal God who understands our existence. We were never alone. Nothing I say in the remaining pages will match the importance of this rediscovered truth, so I won't even try for that. I hope instead to help us start to think about the breadth of its importance. When I said at the start that who we are has everything to do with how we ought to live, I didn't mean this in a moralistic sense. Certainly the nihilistic message that David Barash preaches to his students is false, but as we've begun to see, God's presence and the deep connection we have with him through personhood has much more exciting implications than the reality of right and wrong. To give us a taste, I want to end by giving us a glimpse of how exciting the transformation of biology would be if a true understanding of its place within the big picture were to take hold. And if biology can be transformed this way, why not other pursuits as well? Laying claim to these prizes will require much hard work, but in the few remaining pages, I hope at least to convince you that prizes of this transformative kind are really out there waiting to be claimed, well worth the labor this will require. We'll start by thinking not about biology, but by another field, one that was bursting with the excitement of newness not so long ago. Mind over matter. In the mid-1930s, the foundations of an entire discipline took shape in the mind of a young Englishman by the name of Alan Turing. Calculating machines had been conceived and built earlier, but Turing's invention was altogether different and better. Where others had invented interesting things, he invented the interesting idea that suddenly made everything click. His conceptual machine, immortalized as the Turing machine, became the defining model for the programmable calculating machines we know as computers. I'm skipping the figure. Turing hit the mark so perfectly that everything else, including much of our common knowledge about computers, turns out to be incidental. We think of computers as electronic devices with keyboards and displays on the outside and silicon chips on the inside because, in our experience, this is what they are. Although it used to be transistors before it was chips. But these familiar objects are only a way of giving physical form to a Turing machine. In fact, long before Turing was born, Charles Babbage designed digital computing machines with rotating gears and cylinders. Such things are long forgotten, but interest in modes of computing have nothing to do with silicon chips lives on. Bringing sense to all this is Turing's insightful way of understanding the essential elements common to all forms of digital computation, including Babbage's. We've become dependent on chip-based computing in recent decades, but we've always been more directly dependent on another kind of computing, this being the kind that occurs inside our brains. I'm referring not to the mental calculations, but rather to the physical processes carried out by the gray matter inside our skulls. For example, for the light that enters our eyes to be translated into a conscious visual scene, it must first be processed by an extraordinarily sophisticated network of neurons in the occipital lobe at the back of our heads. And I might add, by another sophisticated set of neurons that are sitting inside of our eyes themselves, and of transfer neurons as well. You might suppose the secrets of this signal processing have yielded to modern brain research, but the truth is that the details remain completely mysterious. In the deepest sense, we do not know how information is processed, stored, or recalled in the brain, said the experts at a recent workshop on brain function. And there's a note behind that. The staggering complexity of the brain structure with its 100 trillion neural connections is certainly one reason for the slow progress. But I have to think that false preconceptions are another. Materialism in particular has constrained thinking within brain science as severely as it has elsewhere. Even the title of that workshop, From Molecules to Minds, is a proclamation of the view that mental processes are grounded in molecular processes. Many outstanding experts see through this. For example, Jeffrey Schwartz, a scientist in the Department of Psychiatry at UCLA School of Medicine, has written a book, The Mind and the Brain, that challenges the idea that we are merely biologically programmed automatons and proves that we have the mental power to shape our brains. People like Schwartz make me think it's possible for the materialistic view to be displaced from its undeserved position of authority. At the same time, I can see how people get caught up in the materialistic view of the mind. Even when computer technology was in its infancy, the idea of computers being thinking machines had a certain seductive appeal. They do seem to think, at least in the sense of arriving at answers we arrive at only after much thought. Since brains are physical things, should we doubt they are thinking things as well? Making thought more sophisticated and less mechanical than computation, but no less physical? However plausible this may appear when approached from that angle, the previous chapter's thought experiment exposes the underlying fallacy. The plain fact is that we consciously ground our thoughts in conceptual realities, not in physical realities. So to claim that the underlying reality of our thought process is physical is to claim that what is actually happening when we think is profoundly different from what we think is happening when we think. Since the conceptual realm is where thinking must occur, if it is to occur at all, the proposition that this realm is not fundamentally real would, if taken seriously, force us to abandon reason as a hopeless pursuit. Thankfully, we have a much more satisfactory alternative. When we accept the fundamental reality of that conceptual realm, we see that computers don't really think after all. Like can openers and mousetraps and robotic pool cleaners, they give the impression of knowing what they're doing, only because their inventors, who really did know what they were doing, imparted genuine cleverness to their designs. As we saw in Chapter 9, the hierarchical structures of these inventions reveal how their inventors thought. Far from being exceptions to this principle, computers and the applications they run are striking examples of it. The human brain is different, though. Being the most remarkable component of the human body, it is arguably the most outstanding physical invention ever to exist. Even more spectacularly, the brain is the one physical invention that serves as an interface between the physical and conceptual worlds. In purely material terms, these connecting points are as nothing, vastly outnumbered, outweighed, and outpowered by the stars in our galaxy, which is only one of 100 billion galaxies. But that assessment flips the moment we take all of reality into account. Significance isn't measured in kilograms or light years because, like truth, it belongs to the realm of ideas. Significance is therefore weighed only by those capable of weighing them, ideas. Once we recognize this, the profound importance of these special locations in our universe becomes apparent. These connecting points are the places, the only places, where the world of atoms and the world of ideas are made to shake hands. Poet meets muse. Sculpture touches stone. Melody finds strings. Ideas flow to paper. Thirst is quenched. Loneliness ended. Absolutely everything of momentous importance in our universe is occurring at these special points, which is why we name and cherish the possessor of each one, why we celebrate their births and mourn their passing. If the galaxies out there were capable of grasping the meaning of the universe, their attention would be fixed on one little planet circling an ordinary star situated in a minor arm of an otherwise ordinary spiral galaxy. What is present on that one little planet makes this particular galaxy, the one named after milk, utterly extraordinary. Two roads. A sobering realization presents itself at this point, followed by an exciting one. If materialism continues to dominate the sciences, then brain research will continue to be driven by the pursuit of something unreal, namely the molecular basis of mind. In that case, we will have missed a huge opportunity to learn about what is real. Of course, any number of facts and physical details will be discovered and cataloged as we continue down this old road. But the full significance of those facts can't possibly be grasped while we labor under a false understanding of what a brain is. On the other hand, if the blinders could somehow be removed in this whole caravan of efforts directed to a new road, one that starts with simple truths about life and follows these to technical truths, might we see huge advantages in a short time? Might we even find that the facts that have already been cataloged add up to something much bigger and much more coherent when interpreted through the right lens? The possibility is intriguing. And what about the rest of biology? After all, the old materialist road has a great many side paths branching off, where specific aspects of life are studied. If we imagine the new road, we see similar branching paths. Scientists who access their work from either of these two roads would be asking many of the same questions, and yet we anticipate major differences on the path marked brain function. What accounts for the major differences? For one thing, biologists who have traveled the materialist road to their specializations never ask why things are as they are, at least not in the deepest sense of the word. If diatom and orca and human are nothing more than leaves drifting on water, then questions of purpose are misplaced. As far as I can tell, the only reason for excitement on the path marked evolution is that no one really can view life in this ho-hum way. Life is so arrestingly compelling that it becomes the spice in what would otherwise be a depressingly bland dish. Wine without cost. This profound disconnect between a Darwinian understanding of life and a true understanding deserves more attention than I can give it here. I'm reminded of the Dawkins-sponsored ads that appeared on the sides of London buses, declaring in bright colors, "There's probably no God, now stop worrying and enjoy your life." Figure 14.3. Interesting logic. You're a meaningless byproduct of the percolating ooze in some ancient pond, soon to return to the dead chemicals that burped your ancestors out. So, go enjoy your life. I have a great deal more respect for Nagel's version of atheism, where the desire to drink the wine on one's own term is acknowledged, but not without a recognized obligation to live off the food on one's own plate. To take this obligation seriously is both admirable and admirably risky. In the end, there may not be a dish that justifies taking the wine on one's own terms. The situation in biology paralyzed the Dawkins disconnect, I think. All biologists are impressed by life. If they weren't, they wouldn't have devoted themselves to studying it. The problem is that life's splendor is so obvious, they tend to take it for granted. Yes, Orcas are the product of blind material forces that had no ability to conceive them. And yes, they take our breath away whenever we watch them. Never mind how these two affirmations fit together, just pretend they do. Life is meaningless. Isn't it beautiful? Two schools. Only a very few research scientists have the opportunity to work against the disjointed view by openly studying life as something clearly and cleverly designed. I'm one, and I can count the others on my fingers. There are more who would like to have this opportunity, as shown every now and then by a paper that gets past the policing system of an establishment science journal. 2 months after this paper on the human hand was published, this is the one that we've talked about before by the Chinese people on the hand, it was retracted. Not by the authors, but by the journal, plus one. And not for any technical error that could be described, but because of, quote, concerns with scientific rationale, presentation, and language. Following publication, readers raised concern about language in the article that made reference to a creator. Evidently, PLOS One marches on command whenever a whistle is blown. Now, if there were a well-known and consistently applied rule forbidding reference to deity in science papers, then I suppose actions of this kind would be excusable. Instead, there is a glaring double standard. A decade ago, 17 pages of the journal Giem were devoted to a rant against intelligent design that had plenty to say about God. All negative, of course. Emil Zuckerkandel, Cronus is a god who cannot be denied by any other god, nor was he by the god of the Jews. No god can be almighty. 10 years on, this one still hasn't been retracted. Maybe nobody raised concerns. I suppose I could have turned this book into a sustained protest against the culture that gives rise to all this injustice. That's not the book I felt I had to be written, though. Instead, my aim has been to show you that there's a much more compelling view of life than the materialist view, and that this compelling view also happens to be innate, known by us from early childhood and stubbornly persistent thereafter, such that to deny it requires sustained efforts. Biologists have to constantly remind themselves. Skipping over a bit, glimpsing the new. I have a strong feeling the new road has no end either. He's just said the old road has no end. But here, the lack of an end is a very good thing. We see hints of the new road even now, as though occasionally a scientist takes a side path from the old road so far that they come within a stone's throw of the new world, new road, maybe without realizing it. I think of Princeton physicist William Bialak, who heads a research team that measures how well various biological functions are performed relative to the lofty standard of physical perfection, he says. Strikingly, when we do this, and there are not so many cases where it has been done, the performance of biological systems often approaches some limits set by basic physical principles. While it is popular to view biological mechanisms as a historical record of evolutionary and developmental compromises, these observations on functional performance point toward a very different view of life as having selected a set of near-optimal mechanisms for its most crucial tasks. The idea of performance near the physical limits crosses many levels of biological organization, from single molecules to cells, to perception and learning in the brain, and I have tried to contribute to this whole range of problems. In other words, in design situations where human engineers would want to push the limits of physical possibility, if they could, we often find that biological systems operate at or near those limits. There's more subtlety to this claim than I can unpack in a few words, and some may be inclined to dismiss it for that reason. To fully grasp the point, you have to look deeply into actual design constraints and objectives. For example, gazelle legs don't propel gazelles to speeds remotely approaching the speed of light, the absolute physical space speed limit. But then, neither would human engineers set out to make an all-terrain vehicle that moves anywhere near that speed. On the other hand, the eyes of cats do approach the physical limits of single photon sensitivity. And the antennae of certain male moths do approach single molecule sensitivity to sex pheromones. And certain enzymes do approach the physical limits of proficiency, processing their reactant molecules so fast as diffusion can deliver them. To anyone with an appreciation of design challenges, the long list of believe-it-or-not facts like these coming from biology is truly astonishing. Again, skipping over a bunch. Common good. Speaking as a human, though, I see something even more beautiful. Yes, the deepest questions in the scientific study of life are up for grabs, and this is exciting for the technically minded. But the deepest truths of life itself, and of human life in particular, were never really up for grabs. These were never restricted to the most clever. Some things, of course, can only be seen by standing on the shoulders of giants. But the most crucial things have always been seen best by standing on the ground. And that concludes the book. My take on this is that I think Axe is correct, that materialism is deficient, not only in its inability to explain inventions, but in its categorical inability to explain ideas, thoughts, and thinkers. And I would add that the brain is not adequate to explain demonstrable properties of the mind. The best one I can give you is memory. Turns out that when certain scientists have experimented by putting probes in the temporal lobe and stimulating them, looking for seizure focuses, the patients who were awake at the time, because they needed to be so that they could tell what was going on, would recall experiences from various times, including from decades ago, including that they were reading a book, the words that they were reading, the noises they were hearing in the meantime, all of the experiences they were experiencing, and not just simply re-experiencing those, but experiencing the memory and still being outside of the memory looking in. Now think about it. How many books have you read? How much data is in those books? There's not enough neurons. I don't even think there's enough synapses to be able to store all of that stuff, one per synapse. I don't think the brain is physically able to connect to all the stuff that we know the mind contains. I agree with Axe that the source of life must be personal and can properly be called God. Finally, I agree that if certain subjects are approached from a not completely reductionist standpoint, certain areas of science can advance in a much more rapid and satisfying way. I would say that also for, I think, creation science. I think the two chapters are good, and I think the whole book is very good. And that's one of the reasons I brought it to the Sabbath School. But that's my opinion. Now it's your turn. Go ahead.
Very good presentation. Very good conclusion. I would just add one dimension here. And I don't want to be misunderstood at all as I do this. There is a feeling, I think, among scientists that science is the prime way of finding out anything. It's superior to anything else. And they say this.
Some people say the only way.
Yeah. And they say this because science is predictable. It seems to me that one can suggest, and don't misunderstand me, that the predictability of science kind of gives it a superiority to the predictability of our thoughts, our emotions, our other things that aren't as predictable, at least on the simplistic materialistic level. When you get above that level, in other words, the scientist has to certainly, the materialistic scientist has to a certain extent an argument of predictability when he deals with simple things of science. He loses completely the argument, though, when he thinks that's all there is to reality. And as has been well prodded in both these chapters here, that there are certain things that we have to face that, why can we ask questions? Altruism. This is escaping all predictability. E.O. Wilson, my apologies to him. Why should we be altruistic? I mean, evolution doesn't push us that way and so on. So why do we have a sense of morality? I think there's an innate sense of morality, which gets close to acts as intuition idea. But it's there. There are those things. Reality is more complex. When you try and boil reality down to a simplistic thing, you may find a little more predictability there, but that's not all truth. You know, some of these scientists come up with the argument, well, thermostats have beliefs. This is tells you a little bit how you try and stretch it. We're dealing with something very much more comprehensive than that when we're talking about our moral beliefs, when we talk about our understanding, our questioning, our certain values we have, and so on. But I think we can understand the materialistic scientists' arrogance, if I can use that term kindly, because they do have a system that's probably a little more predictable than other systems, but that's due to its simplicity, not due to its approach to truth.
Well, one comment I will make, and that is that one of the deeper thinkers that we've had, Pascal, I believe it was, or maybe it was Descartes, I forget which one, who said, I think, therefore I am. That was what? Which one, Descartes?
Descartes.
Descartes, okay. But anyway, basically the reasoning behind that was that, you know, illusions can happen. And that the senses, which seem to me to be so reliable, well, we know that on occasion they deceive us. You take a color wheel with red, blue, and green. You spin it very rapidly, and it turns into a kind of a gray-white color. It doesn't really. That fools us. It's really red, blue, and green. We just can't see it. There are books full of optical illusions of various kinds. Straight lines, one of which seems to be longer than the other. The two lines appear to be curved. And that's reliable most people see it that way. There are optical illusions that, you know, there's a famous dress that's been on the internet, and there's vigorous debates on whether it's white and gold or whether it's blue and black. And some people see it one way and some people see it another way. And there are various arguments as to which one is correct in how they see it. I won't try to solve that problem today, although I think there is probably a reasonable solution. But what I can tell you is that our eyes are prone to deceive us on occasion. Well, he said, maybe, you know, our thoughts deceive us on occasion too. There are dreams that seem real. There is reality that seems dreamlike. Just the other day, after the third debate, the moderator, and I'm blanking on his name right now. Pardon me?
Chris Wallace
was being interviewed about the debate, and he was saying the first 10 minutes he heard this voice and he realized it was his voice. But the instant feeling about it was that it was somebody else's, you know? You know, those kinds of things happen. Our minds can be deceived. But as Descartes pointed out, one thing we can't be deceived about is that we exist. And that is the fundamental issue for each one of us. It's possible that I'm deceived into thinking that you exist, and you really don't, vice versa.
Couldn't you argue that you really don't exist, you just think you exist?
Well, the problem is then, what thinks that you exist? And that's the fundamental problem. And yet, evolutionary psychology has come to the conclusion that we don't really exist, that we are an epiphenomenon, that we are an illusion. And so what you have here is a philosophy that disagrees with the only experimental datum any of us has that is irrefutable. Think about that. Yes.
There is a text I like. But the natural man receiveth not the things of God, for to him there are foolishness. Neither can he, for spiritual things are only spiritually discerned. Now we always think of that as only spiritual things, like what's in the Bible. But I wonder if that might not apply to scientists as well.
I think you're right about that. I think that there comes a point where you can deny enough of reality to where you can come to a scientific meeting and say, I believe that there is no real personhood, that it's all an illusion. So I think that the Doug Axe is onto something that, if you think about it, is really very powerful. It simply can't be the way materialists perceive it as being. Because if it were, they couldn't perceive. And I think that that pushes us out of materialism and into at least some form of minds in addition to nature.
It's like saying there is no absolute reality.
Are you absolutely sure of that?
Then your statement can't be correct. If there is, that's an absolute statement, isn't it? So it's just so self-contradictory. It's nonsense. Becomes nonsense.
We have a comment in the back here. You may have to come down for this.
Well, the only way I can think that I'm an illusion is the simple fact that I'm not.
And I think that the entire attempt to exclude mind is a hopeless one. And I think that once you stop doing that, you have to raise the question, are there other minds? Because we have evidence of another mind that's far beyond ours, all over nature. And once you've categorically ruled out the possibility that you can flatten everything onto the material plane, then you have to raise that interesting question of God. And for some, the scary question of God, the question they'd really rather avoid, because there's a problem with authority at this point.
Well, I think the materialists would have a stronger argument if their system was anywhere near plausibly workable. But you have to come back always to a simple question, you know, which Doug asks, as you'll find out next week probably. I don't know what you're talking about next week, but I guess. You get back into that material world, you got an impossible situation there. How did life arise? All by itself.
Well, his experiments not only asked the question of how life arose, but they also asked the question, how do you get from one form of life to another? And as we'll see, that's also hopeless. Not only is the origin of life a big hole in evolutionary theory, but it turns out there's holes all over getting from one form of life to another with all the changes that have to be made and getting, you know, a jump from one organism to another requires jumps of such a size that they are perhaps not comparable directly to the origin of life, but they're certainly comparable in terms of their defiance of the laws of probability.
And that opens the door to the question about why do we have minds? Which is, you know, what he's talking about here today.
Yeah.
Incomprehensible.
Because something created us with minds.
And then characteristics that just totally challenge evolution.
Yeah.
Like altruism.
Right. And characteristics that totally challenge evolution from inside the scientific point of view. Again, when we're discussing this, you want to keep in mind that there are two very sharply different definitions of science. One of them is what most scientists publish in the literature. And I say that because now that is distinct from what most scientists believe. most scientists actually believe in a God. 50-some percent.
Designer.
Designer of some kind.
I don't know. It's what, 30? Well, 37% believe in God and 13-14% believe in a designer,
But it's actually a majority.
Deity, yeah.
I mean, maybe not the personal God of the Jews or something like that, but a God, a person with such superior intellect to us that it would be very understandable to worship that person.
Deity is the word. That
deity
was
is probably a good word, but that's just Greek for God. I mean, let's be honest here. We can dispute about the origin of this person, the attributes of this person, et cetera, et cetera. But the idea that there is a God is actually a majority view in science, contrary to what the published literature says. But the point of it is that there is also another view of science, and that is science is activities that can trace back to the study of the reproducible. And whether scientists, people who claim to be scientists, are really doing science is an open question by that definition. And I would submit that those two definitions may come to two diametrically opposed conclusions. And if they do, I submit that the underlying structure of science is such that conclusions derived from the experiments on the reproducible are more fundamentally authoritative than people who call themselves scientists, or even people whom other people have called scientists by calling them PhDs. That the underlying part of science is really not even a democracy, let alone a monarchy. It is actually a subject that is built up from evidence and reasonable inferences. And that the majority of scientists, or the majority of published scientists, or publishable scientists, disagree with that, then they're wrong. And that the method is more reliable than those people. And I think one of the things that Douglas Sachs has done is he has shown that by that definition of science, reproducible experiments and reasonable inferences therefrom. That the scientific consensus is flat out wrong. Whether it comes around to his view in the end or doesn't, whether it comes around to his view in our lifetime or doesn't, it's wrong.
Major concepts of evolution are not reproducible.
That's exactly right. And in fact, when you defend evolution by saying, that was then when they were all more flexible, and now they've gotten kind of more hardened into the tracks that they're in, what you are saying is, evolution is not reproducible. Therefore, by the most fundamental definition of science, it is outside of science. Anyway, we're going to see some of those evidences that he has that lead him to the confidence to write this book next week. If you want the references, those of you who have the email, I'll send them to you. Those of you who don't have the email, give me your address. I'll send it to you. I guess you can pick it up from somebody else in Sabbath school. See you next week.